Oh,
Nobunita. Excuse me. Nobunita, I'm talking to Nobunita Paul. Yeah.
Nobunita, yes,
just check your WhatsApp once. I've texted you something.
Sure.
Thank you. Good morning to all present with us today. I, Zakia Kalam, on behalf of the Department of English, Chatta College, cordially welcome you all to the third session of our CBCS curriculum-based web lecture series, organized by our department in association with the IQAC Chatta College. This has been organized primarily for the students. Since this happens to be the third session of our lecture series, I will not dwell upon introducing it formally to you anymore. I would rather move on to our chief guest today. I most warmly welcome Dr. Shourav Dash Thakur. He is currently teaching at Vishwabharati University as an associate professor in the Department of English. Although sir had commissioned me to speak just till here, I would claim a few more words in sir's honor, and also because I think it will delight our students to know about him. Sir's pedigree can be traced back to JNU. It is from there that he had completed his master's. It can also be traced back to JU. It is from there that he acquired his PhD. His PhD concerns postmodern novels, if I'm not wrong, and his area of interest concerns literatures of modernism, postcolonial literatures, children's literature, culture studies. His interest also extends to the very core of Bengali literature, also to Rabindranath. In fact, he has many papers to his credit that exclusively address Rabindranath. Sir has also co-edited a volume titled Shongit Natok. Although I could say more, but I would rather now confine my words till here, and I would let sir present his paper, which is titled All That Is Solid Melts Into Air, Reading Modernism in T.S. Eliot's Book. Before we begin the session, it's a humble request to all. Please keep your audios and videos on mute. There will be an interactive session after sir's lecture, so the students are requested to drop the questions in the chat box. Thank you, sir. Now over to you, the virtual mic. Please, sir.
Thank you very much, Zakia, and Dr. Dash, the head of the department of your college. Sir, am I audible? Am I clearly audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. I think sooner rather than later, I would kind of put my video off because that might create bandwidth problems later on. So I just speak to you from behind the clouds, so to say, so that we can keep talking even after the presentation. So I'm switching my video off. Thank you, Zakia, first of all, and Dr. Dash for giving me this opportunity to interact with the students of the Department of English, Chatta College. But it's always a pleasure and a gratifying experience to talk to students from such quote-unquote hinterlands, okay? Because they give me a sense of my own roots, first of all, and secondly, since they are very far away from the metropolitan center of English academia, I think they deserve this kind of interactions with teachers and senior students like us more than students who are located in Kolkata and other metropolitan centers. So it's always a pleasure to talk to you. I would kind of look forward to intense interaction with you once my humble kind of presentation is over. It's not going for a formal presentation because as Zakia told me kind of in no uncertain terms that this is primarily meant for students and not for teachers and other colleagues. So I've tried to be as simple, as lucid, as down-to-earth as possible so that things are clear to you. And at the same point of time, let me also kind of submit by way of some kind of, some not excuse, but some kind of explanation that since we have three long poems in the syllabus, right? Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, Hollow Men, and Preludes, I guess. Am I right, Zakia?
Yes, sir. In the syllabus. Yes, sir.
Okay. So since it's primary for students, I would like to concentrate primarily on the poems. I would try to make a kind of as close a reading of these poems as possible. But at the same point of time, I'm quite aware of the fact that lots of materials on these poems, in particular in Eliot in general, or modernism in general, are available on the internet. Your teachers are also there. So maybe at times my reading of these poems with you might turn out to be somewhat banal. So I would kind of try and avoid that kind of situation. I would try and share with you maybe my own personal experience of reading Eliot to an extent. And also try and give you, if possible, as far as I can, something that maybe would not be easily available on the internet. And that is another reason why I would start from the other. I would not start with these poems by Eliot, but I'd start with the discourse of modernism, the paradigm of modernism at large. Because look, modernism not being a text per se, it may not be that easy for students to kind of locate or pin down materials from the internet on modernism. So this is a kind of ubiquitous movement, it's an ubiquitous rather kind of airy kind of concept. Airy in what sense I'll explain a little later, but it is takes a somewhat concrete, okay? Because they have names, they have their own authors, etc. For example, Love's Mutual. So you just Google Love's Mutual, lots of materials will be available on this. And many of them are quite reliable material too. But at the same point of time, we think of modernism, it's a little bit abstruse, a little bit abstract, far less concrete than the concrete poems. So modernism, yes, is of course a text in the modern post-structural sense of the term. Everything is a text in the post-structuralist paradigm, in the paradigm which was introduced by people like Rolla Bahr and Michel Foucault, later on, 1960s onwards. But in a more traditional sense of the term text, modernism is not a text, it's a movement. So a movement is always a kind of a little bit difficult to handle rather than a single text. A text is somewhat limited in that sense. But of course, we will kind of try and problematize this very idea over the next 1 hour or so, that how we can kind of delimit the text. So a text, as Foucault and many other post-structuralists have taught us, is not a kind of limited entity. It's not merely a kind of series of words or a series of play with any kind of medium, since it's not merely about literary text alone, since a painting is also a text, a film is also a text, a song, a piece of music is no less a text. So it's not merely kind of verbal creation, it might be any kind of creation. Somebody says, Joy Mondal says, my voice is big. Is there any problem in the audio? Zakia?
Sir, it's a bit of an echo that we can hear. And it's somewhat, yes, it is kind of breaking, as somebody said, yes.
What do I do then? Probably network problem or something like that. Anyway, so I hope things will improve a little later. Yes, so as I was trying to point out, at one level a text, a poem, which is a verbal text, a painting, which is a visual text, a text, I mean, all kinds of medium-based texts. These are all medium-based texts. The medium can be verbal language, visual language like color, pen and paper, light and darkness, light and shade, etc. These are all kind of media for the art of painting. And similarly, each and every art form has its own language, has its own medium. At one level, the text is a kind of a limited creation or limited representation. Not necessarily creation alone, because again, another important aspect of the post-structuralist framework. Okay, I'm talking about post-structuralist framework right now because I think that framework would be necessary, quite required for us to understand the modernist framework too. So that's why I'm trying to kind of making a roundabout attempt at making kind of retrospective entry into modernism by way of talking, invoking post-structuralism first. That might help us to understand modernism better, in fact. So yes, at one level, the text is a kind of limited representation within a particular space, within the space of a particular page in the book, within the space of the canvas, etc., or within the frame of the photograph. So a text is a representation within the limited space, within the kind of demarcated space. So this demarcated space, the idea of demarcated space is important here. some kind of play, some kind of process of signification with language, any kind of language, not necessarily verbal language alone, any kind of medium. So yes, that is one sense in which we make sense of the text. But at the same point of time, as post-structuralists have made us aware, that the text is not necessarily limited within the page. A verbal text, a poem is not necessarily limited within the page. A painting is not necessarily limited within the canvas. It is precisely, some radical post-structuralists claim that we need to kind of look beyond the page to really actualize the text. What the page does is to give a kind of potential text, potential, that's possible text, possible text. So at the page, for example, the page on which the first few stanzas of the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock is printed, is published, is just an enabling occasion. That is not the text in that sense. They just enable us to potentialize the text, rather actualize the text, to materialize the text, to invent the text, to make the text, to bring the text into existence. That is the idea. So from potential to actuality, okay? From the enabling occasion to materialization, from the limitation of the physical page, okay? From the tangible page to a kind of delimited entity, or unlimited social cultural space. So that's the kind of journey that we readers need to read the text to be. Okay. So we need to kind of make the text kind of delimit itself, to extend itself beyond the demarcating limitations of the page. So because at the end of the day, Foucault told us, following of course Barthes' footsteps, that a text is never created by the author alone, nor is it complete through the reader's intervention as well. Some people think that because of certain misinterpretations of certain rather hyperbolic expressions, hyperbolic sentences given by people like the death of the author, who's what is an author and what not, they believe that okay, the death of the author is merely about the birth of the reader. So it is the author and the reader who together make the text possible. But that's an illusion. It's not merely about the author and the reader alone. Okay? Because the author is not an individual, nor is the reader. So the individuality, so it's possible to be the death of the author, is not the real problematic. That's not the fundamental problematic that God is talking about. What he's basically trying to draw our attention to is the death of the subject, death of the individual, that there's nothing called a kind of limited, specific, concrete, demarcated subject or individual. For example, I am not completely I. My I-ness is always subject to scrutiny. It does not stand scrutiny. And nor are you a kind of completely radically segregated, radically separated you alone. So my I-ness and your you-ness, these are all subject to not only scrutiny, but also subject to various kinds of interpellations and assimilations. So I don't exist without you, nor do you exist, nor can you exist without me. So this you is, not you are. So you is again. So this you is kind of intertwined in always a kind of dialectic or dialectic relationship with the I. So this problematic of I and you is the most important problematic taken up by people like Barthes and Foucault in the post-structuralist world. So what the challenge primarily is not the figure of the author really, as it is often. Yes, Madhumita, do you want to say anything? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sure of that. Is it by any chance, is it possible to go to, or rather to make the network a bit feasible? Your voice is cracking actually.
Then wait a second.
I can hear properly.
just give me a minute or two, okay? Hello, Zakia?
Sure.
Hello, can you hear me, everybody? Zakia?
Is
it better now?
Yes, sir, it is better now.
Okay, thank you. Just a minute. Okay, can I continue now?
Absolutely, sir, it's crystal clear now.
Okay, thank you. So yes, what I was telling is that the post-structuralists give us an impression of this is a kind of wrong impression we derive from their work. Actually, this is our problem, not theirs, that they're talking about the death of the author. They are not. They're talking about the death of the subject, death of the individual, or the idea of individuality. That the idea of radical individuality is no more applicable, especially in the post-Second World War or quote-unquote post-humanistic, post-industrial Euro-American universe in particular, and maybe they're trying to extend this entire paradigm to the entire global culture. But the point is precisely that. It's not merely the death of the author, because if the subjectivity itself is the bone of contention, or the loss of subjectivity or impossibility of subjectivity is the fundamental bone of contention, then probably we cannot think of an integrated kind of unified concrete reader either, because the reader in the traditional perception is no less an individual, no less a subject than the author himself or herself. So if the author is dead, by the same logic, the reader cannot go on living. So it's not merely a case of the figure of the death of the author. By the same logic, the integrated individual reader also kind of faced the challenge of complete extinction. So what does one mean by the birth of the author, birth of the reader, at the cost of the death of the author? In a different sense, reader is an idea, just as the author cannot exist as an individual, but the author does indeed keep living in the form of an idea. Likewise, the reader also lives in the form of an idea. What is that idea? The reader is a discourse, much like the author himself or herself. And that's why it's not no more a himself or herself. Because if there is no individuality, you cannot talk about one's gender or one's individual human being. Okay, so that beingness is outside the ballpark. That is the problem. So if one is not an individual, it's neither a he nor a she. It's just an it. That's why Foucault's telling question is not who is an author, but what is an author. So authorship is an idea. So the author is a discourse or an entity, an abstract entity. Again, so the concreteness, the locatedness of the author as well as that of the reader, or those of the reader, is challenged. And both these individualistic entities are replaced by certain discourses or discursive ideas of the author and the reader. So these are all ideas. So likewise, A text is no more a kind of concrete entity limited within the four sides, four demarcating sides of a page or four demarcating sides of a painting canvas. A text is no less an entity, no less an idea which needs to extend itself. So it's all about diffusion. It's all about diffusion. It's all about sacrificing one's concreteness or embracing some kind of abstraction. So everything at the end of that is a kind of discursive entity. Everything is a discursive entity. So many things come together to form me, to form you, form everything and everybody else in the world. So the concreteness is replaced by kind of abstract kind of perception of things. So this idea is what way earlier. So this is how I propose to kind of come back to or go back to the idea of modernism. This is the idea what George Lukács, the famous Marxist critic of modernism of the 1930s, the Hungarian critic, described as reification. Now, it is not the post-structuralists who first talked about this idea of abstraction, okay? This idea of loss of concrete subjectivity for individuals or loss of concrete identity, specificity by objects or things like texts, etc. So this kind of discursification, this kind of abstraction is, in a nutshell, described as reification by George Lukács. And for Lukács and many other critics of the 1930s onwards, it's not really a phenomenon. Clearly, they could not anticipate what would happen in the 1960s and after. So obviously, since they were talking about all these things in the 1930s and after, so obviously, this entire phenomenon, which are often kind of understood to be postmodern or post-structuralist, can be logically traced back to at least the early 20th century, if not still earlier. Okay, so in fact, George Lukács traces this problem to high capitalism. Okay, now this capitalism again itself is a discourse which needs to be understood in a little bit detail because obviously we don't have the time to kind of go into any deep discussion, any detailed discussion, proper discussion that it deserves in this lecture. So. Capitalism makes abstract things out of concrete, okay? So it reifies things. It reifies things, reifies objects, reifies individuals, it reifies relationships, relationship between individuals, relationship between individual and an object. For example, relationship between the author and her kind of creation or her property, that is the text. So all these things are somewhat reified. This reification, again, was kind of anticipated as early as the mid-19th century by none other than Karl Marx in this phrase, all that is solid melts into air, which forms the first part of the title of my presentation today, all that is solid melts into air, okay? So solid things lose their solidity, concrete things lose their concreteness, things become abstract. Sab kichu dhoate hoye jacche. That is the idea. So the idea of concrete truth, idea of reality, okay, idea of knowledge. So all these start to become somewhat hazy, somewhat questionable. They undergo, at least it can be safely said that all these ideas start to undergo radical changes, at least since the mid-19th century, if not still earlier. Okay, so idea of knowledge, idea of truth, and idea of subjectivity in that sense, idea of relationships, and finally, the idea of representation, because literary works or all artistic works at one level are about representation, representation of knowledge, representation of reality. So reality was perceived to be no more concrete, but abstract. Okay, knowledge was perceived to be no more a kind of available, but to be constructed. Knowledge is to be constructed. Knowledge was not really available. In other words, the Victorian 19th century scientific discourse of concrete, objective, empirical, epistemological reality, okay, based on the idea of verification or verisimilitude, the idea of objective entity or objective reality, And all these ideas were in a way linked with the late 19th century heyday of scientific realism. So those late Victorian ideas came to be clearly challenged by this newly emergent ideas of reality as constructed rather than given. Okay, knowledge being subjective rather than objective. So things become more and more subjective, more and more speculative, more and more interpretative, rather than given, objective, universal, concrete, and so on and so forth. So the idea that it is human perception, it is human intellection as well as emotionality. So all these are central to knowledge formation, clearly kind of quote-unquote non-scientific kind of idea. Okay, science believes in concrete, physical, given, universal, objective realities. So what is so constructed about the sun rising every day in the east? There is nothing constructed about that, but these are physical realities. So there might still be something certain, something concrete, something dependable about these concrete, natural, physical, phenomenological realities. But beyond that, nothing is certain. Everything is a matter of construction, perception, interpretation, and therefore subjective understanding. So you construct your own knowledge. You create your own knowledge. Okay. So there is nothing called universal knowledge. All knowledges are discursively constructed. All knowledges are socially located. So in that sense, so is an individual. An individual is not a matter of a kind of concrete knowledge, but an individual is a matter of, an individual is a subject. An individual is a subject to be constructed socially, politically, culturally. Okay. So many ideas, many discourses, many forces, okay, many cultural impetuses. So all these go into the making of an individual. It may be I, it may be you, it may be a particular text. So all these are subjectivities rather than individualities. And they are constructed by all these or innumerable social forces, which again themselves are ubiquitous. It's a kind of global network. So innumerable forces come in to make you, to make me, to make everything and everybody in the world. This is clearly decentered. When I talk about these innumerable forces, these forces are clearly unpatterned. They don't have any structure. That's why they call it post-structuralism. So they're unstructured, they're fluid, okay? They're once more demarcated. One does not know where to begin and where to end. There is no center, nor there is any kind of specific locatable periphery. So all these dyads, binary opposition like center, margin, man, woman, man, nature, culture, by which? So these are the binaries or dyads which came into existence in the late 19th century, by which social sciences, literature, literary studies, academia thrived. But all these quote-unquote binary oppositions or dyads came to be problematized by the 1930s and the 1940s around the Second World War, where they were talking about the breakdown of all these binary oppositions, breakdown of these dyads, and they were trying to inspire us to see everything in everything. Okay, so I am in you just as you are in me. Okay, so Eliot, for example, is not only inside Eliot. Eliot must be traced within the larger network of the modernist paradigm. But not merely the modernist paradigm alone, because if we kind of follow this logic to its logical conclusion, but of course not conclusion, because this is a kind of unending process. There's nothing called conclusion or introduction in this process, just as spatially speaking, there's nothing called center and margin. Likewise, temporally speaking, there's nothing called the beginning and the ending. So it's all a kind of nest of time and nest of space, a kind of huge tempo-spatial category. Okay, a huge tempo-spatial category where there is no beginning or ending, nor is there any center or margin. So in that sense, Eliot needs to be located not only in modernism. We can trace him back to the earlier movements to which modernism itself is indebted, but not merely that. It's not ultimately about going back, making a backward journey in search of some kind of quote-unquote origin. Because at the end of the day, if we follow this logic, there's nothing called pure origin. So purity of truth, purity of knowledge has already been problematized, as I have just pointed out, because everything is everything. Everything has to be located elsewhere. Okay, the self is to be traced not only in the self, but probably more important in the other. And let us remember that there is no one concrete traceable other. The other is always, the others are always many, just as the selves are. So it's always a play. It's always a play. Play of many selves and many others. So that's why Derrida talked about structure, sign, and play in the discourse of human sciences. So this play continues, and there are innumerable players, countless, so I mean signifiers and signifieds, and the play is never going to come to an end, and therefore it doesn't have any beginning either. Okay, it began as early as creation, and it will go on right up to the end of this universe, or right up to the death of this universe. So both are clearly kind of abstract kind of points of departure. So clearly there's nothing called concrete origin. So modernism in that sense does not have any origin either. Okay, so challenging the idea of origin, and to extend that idea, originality too. We have already talked about the impossibility of purity, purity of truth, purity of knowledge. So everything is hybrid, everything is impure, everything is constructed, everything is a kind of heteroglossy of many ideas, many discourses, a network of positions. If that is one thing, the other idea is there is nothing called originality either. So, I mean, nothing is original. Nobody is completely original. Okay, so isn't that the idea that Eliot is kind of invoking in his essay Tradition and Individual Talent? An individual talent becomes an individual talent only by way of locating itself within a tradition. And that tradition is a kind of, again, ubiquitous tradition, an abstract tradition. If you go back to that text by Eliot, you will see that he's not talking about the poetic tradition alone. He's talking about many traditions together. In fact, it is these many traditions rolled into one, which is signified in Eliot's notion of tradition. He's talking about the poetic tradition. And then again, which poetic tradition? Is it about the British poetic tradition alone? Because Eliot was not merely a British citizen. He was an Anglo-American person. So he has dual citizenship. He was both a British person and an American person. Yes. So is he talking only about the British and American poetic traditions? Is he talking about the literary traditions at large belonging to these two countries? Is he talking about the Euro-American or European poetic tradition? Is he talking about the European cultural tradition at large, comprising not only the poetic, not also only the literary, but also many other traditions? For example, say, visual tradition, for example, moral tradition, spiritual tradition, metaphysical tradition. So all these various traditions which go on to make up our mind. Okay, so these we all are children of all these many traditions. Okay, so we, by virtue of being born, carry the legacy. Okay, bear on our shoulders the very heavy burden of innumerable traditions. Okay, of which we are children. So and then again, is it merely about the European tradition alone, or Eliot is talking about the, or isn't he somewhere constructing the idea of a kind of more holistic, more inclusive Western tradition? For example, if you talk about his Westland, the pun involved in the word West, it's both West as well as West. So it's a Westland, but also there's a hint that it is the entire Western culture which has reduced itself to a huge Westland, a land of cactus, a cactus land, a desert land. So the wastage of the entire West. So which tradition is he talking about? But then again, is he really stopping there? Is that the limit of Eliot's imagination of a tradition? Isn't he also talking about the global tradition? Because in many of his poems, okay, including the poems that we are going to briefly read a little later, isn't he also kind of drawing on non-Western traditions too? Okay, non-Western metaphysical traditions, non-Western literary traditions as well. So the idea is that this tradition again is not concrete. Okay, it is not tempo specially limited. It's again a no less ubiquitous entity, no less quote unquote confusing, abstract, no less a network kind of entity without an origin, without any center, without any margin, without any beginning or an end, without any kind of any air of concreteness about it. So it's all holistic. It's all there in the air. So again, so the earlier notion of tradition, remember that the idea of tradition was very much there. I mean, it was a kind of heated, it was an object of heated debate since the late 19th century itself in England. For example, Matthew Arnold in his book Culture and Anarchy talks about one kind of tradition. F.R. Lewis in his The Great Tradition talks about another kind of tradition. Eliot in its Notes Towards a Definition of Culture, which came out in 1948, talks about yet another kind of tradition. Meanwhile, tradition in individual talent talks about another kind of tradition. But look, most of them talk about traditions, a kind of concrete, locatable, primarily British or at best an European entity. Okay, but Eliot's text, Tradition in Individual Talent, tries to delimit it. And this way, in my reading, he is like many other modernists, of course. But then again, it's not merely about modernism, as I have just pointed out. Many earlier thinkers, including Karl Marx, did already talk about the ubiquitousness of everything concrete. Okay, so yes, so Eliot, among many of them, is anticipating some of the basic concerns of the post-structuralist paradigm, which would emerge only in the 1960s and the 70s. So having said that, we need to kind of briefly summarize what we have understood so far. So what we have, suggested or argued so far. Number one, the idea of concrete empirical reality based on mimesis or verisimilitude or based on the idea of verification, which was central to the Victorian realist poetics, Victorian realist paradigm, that started to be challenged towards the 1880s, 1890s with the arrival of proto-modernism. Okay. Proto-modernism in the hand of some noted French poets like Baudelaire, Valéry, Mallarmé, and so on and so forth. And there were also certain proto British moderns like Oscar Wilde and others who were trying to move beyond the realist paradigm. So they were again talking about the impossibility of final truth or final knowledge, number one. Number two, since the verifiable, objective, concrete, mimetic notion of reality was suspect now, since that external visible or tangible reality was passé now, a new alternative notion of reality emerged, reality as subjective, reality as constructed, reality as ideational, reality as discursive. Hello? Hello, is there any problem?
No, sir. Did anybody unmute? Sir, you continue. Please keep your audios on mute. Probably Hoytokaro's audio was unmuted or something. Carry on, okay. Sir.
Yes. So that new modernist notion of reality, an alternative reality, was emerging. A reality more subjective, more based on individual consciousness. But then again, as I just pointed out, the idea of individual itself was subject to contention, subject to debate. So the idea of I or I-ness or subjectivity, that was a huge bone of contention for the post-realists, for the modernist salon, and that debate still continues. But there was more or less a kind of agreement among the modernists that, look, the real reality is inside, not outside. That's in your consciousness, okay, or in your subconscious. But of course, the idea of subconscious was yet to come into vogue, because Freud would appear in the scenario only in the late 1890s, and Freud's most important works would hit the stands only in the first couple of decades of the 20th century. And then again, let's remember that in his initial days, even Freud was dismissed or condescendingly looked upon as unscientific, as kind of superstitious mumbo jumbo and all. So yes, the Freudian discourse of subconscious or our unconscious were not yet in quite vogue in the time that we are talking about, 1880s and 1890s. But again, a kind of discursive space was emerging, in which Freud would find its foothold later on, because people had already started to problematize the idea of reality as external, as given, as objective, as sensible or tangible, or as finally as intelligible. Okay, so at the end of the day, it's not intelligible either. You cannot make sense of it completely. To an extent, yes, but not completely. Reality is, or perception of reality is, beyond complete comprehension. It cannot be understood, cannot be captured completely or comprehensively. Captured in what sense? Captured in the sense of construction of reality or perception of reality by a disintegrated individual, or by now disintegrated subject. In other words, it's impossible for me to understand what reality is in its absoluteness, in its completeness, in its comprehensive totality. So the idea of wholeness, idea of totality itself was challenged. So that we can have glimpses of reality. That is the idea. Ek to kuch hua lage. We can have glimpses of reality. We can have ideas of reality, but we can never know for sure what reality is. We always need to kind of bear in mind that there is always more than I can probably think, more than I can capture, more than I can be aware of. So it's all a matter of delimitation again at the end of the day. So the challenge is always to kind of extend yourself, to try and chase this golden deer called reality. So reality is unknowable. It's possible to an extent, but it's unknowable, unrepresentable to your own self, because knowing is representation at one level. Okay, because what I know is basically what I can represent to myself. What I cannot understand, what I cannot represent to myself, remains beyond my knowledge, remains beyond my perceptions. So I cannot know that. So I cannot know. I cannot have a kind of clear idea of what reality is. So at one level, knowledge is about representation. So that kind of representation is always partial, always fractured, and always kind of conditional. So it always depends on where you are and when you are. So your time and your space determine what you are representing to yourself and to others. So your rootedness is very important. Okay, or in other words, knowledge is always a matter of context. Knowledge is context specific. There is nothing called universal knowledge. So if that is a matter of a problem of knowledge production or epistemology, that is the problem of knowing things around us, problem of constructing reality for ourselves, that problem of representation is extended to the domain of artistic production or reproduction too, because artistic production reproduction is no less a matter of representation. Okay, when an Eliot writes a poem, he's representing something. When a Joyce writes a novel, he's representing something. When a Chaplin kind of produces a movie, okay, directs a movie or acts in that movie, he's also representing something. When a Virginia Woolf is writing a novel, writing about feminism, she is representing something. So creation is also a kind of representation, okay, just as knowledge is a kind of representation. So in that sense, we are all authors, we are all readers, and all our creative or representational endeavors are necessarily fractured and limited, and nothing is beyond problematization. Nothing is beyond challenging. So the idea is there was new notion of reality. So there was a kind of clear epistemological break, and that demanded a kind of invention of new modes of representation too, at the individual level as well as at the authorial or the artistic level. Because if reality changes, then modes of representation of that reality in the work of art must also change. If reality changes, then probably you cannot kind of hang on to the age-old or dated modes of representation any longer. Okay, you need to kind of discover, invent, adopt, formulate new representations or new modes of representation, or in that sense, you need to invent new languages of representation to do at least partial justice to the new, the novel notion of reality. Okay, so because we can never do complete justice to it, because that is impossible, because reality is never a matter of knowing but a matter of comprehension. So a break in the notion of reality, it was a new reality, and break in the notion of representation. So these are central to the modernist creative framework. Okay, new reality, new modes of representation, clearly both demanding radical experimentations. So you have to experiment in capturing this reality. And it has already been more or less accepted by everybody that this new reality cannot be known in a kind of scientific manner. So traditional realism, which is scientific with a clear beginning, middle, and an end, with well-formulated, grammatically correct sentences, as a well-organized novelistic structure, as one often comes across in the Victorian narrative paradigm, in your Austens, in your Dickenses, in your George Eliots, in your Bronte sisters, etc. So that is passé. Okay. So a fractured reality, okay, demands a kind of fractured kind of representation. And secondly, since this reality is no more outside, this reality is inside in my consciousness. So we need to invent novel media to represent this consciousness. So the traditional empirical realism became replaced by a new kind of realism altogether. It's not that realism, made a kind of grand exit. It's only that one kind of realism made way for another kind of realism. That is something, students, you must bear in mind. The traditional late 19th century Victorian realism was replaced by a new kind of realism. And in that sense, modernism is no less a kind of realism, because it claimed to be actually more realistic, more authentically realistic than the preceding artists were, the Victorian realists were. So psychological realism or interior realism became the new order of the day. Okay. And obviously, there was breakdown everywhere. And of course, till now we have been talking about primarily the textual or the narrative or the philosophical or the artistic world. But obviously, there is also a kind of sociology of modernism. I would not go into those details because time is fast running out. This is going to be a kind of important motif in Eliot's poem. Time is running out, or maybe there will be time, etc. In my back, I always hear, remember Marvel? In my back, I always hear time's winged chariot hurrying near to his coy mistress. In my back, I'm hearing right now the time's winged chariot is hurrying near. So yes, sociology of modernism, there's breakdown, fragmentation everywhere, even in the late 19th century. Okay, you are more or less aware of all these things. So that's why I kind of only give you a couple of remarks on this and then pass on to the next stage. So many people think that quite wrongly that modernism was initiated, inaugurated as a kind of social repercussion of the world wars. Had there been no world wars, there would not have been any modernism. But remember that the first world war took place only in the middle of the second decade of the 20th century, by which time the modernist generation was more or less established. Okay, the proto-modernists actually have already exited the stage. Your Conrads, your Fosters, your Henry Jameses, and so on and so forth. And the second generation of modernists like Eliot, Joyce, Woolf, and others, they have already descended, and Yeats, of course, they have already descended upon the scenario. And other people will follow, of course, after the First World War. So the First World War probably was the last straw that broke the camel's back. But the straws were nevertheless accumulating on the camel's back, on the weak, Western, deteriorated, degraded camel's back. Or straws had been accumulating, okay, on that weak, impoverished camel's back since at least the early 19th century. So once more, we need to go back to the Eliotian idea that, look, there is nothing called a kind of specific origin. People have talked about the originary point of modernism in various ways. Somebody has located, even some famous critics, have talked about the First World War as the originary point of modernism. Some have talked about the rise of French, innumerable French isms, surrealism, expressionism, impressionism, vorticism, and many others in the 1870s and 1880s. And still some others have talked about the early 19th century, which, in my opinion, is a far more kind of logical, far more acceptable kind of argument. So this whole discourse of fragmentation, alienation, reification, and all sorts of uncertainties, all these kind of started to creep into the Western social, physical, and metaphysical consciousness as early as at least the 1840s, 50s. And remember that Marx was talking about all these, many of these ideas in a different language, of course, in the 1840s itself. So this whole, all these baggages can actually be traced back to the rise of capitalism, industrialism. Okay, it's a kind of post-industrial society, rampant urbanization, breakdown of the traditional British, American, European society at large, breakdown of the natural order, metaphysical order, moral order, spiritual order, all these things. But yes, so all these breakdowns or fractures or ruptures must be if to be captured in a kind of somewhat faithful manner, somewhat authentic manner in the new modernist text, then the form or structure of the works, okay, must also be commensurately fractured or fragmented or ununified. If the reality around lacks unity, you cannot afford to kind of work of art, an integrated whole, okay, a work in unity. So that would be a kind of travesty of travesty in representation, because subject matter and form, theme and form, must go hand in hand. It is your theme which in a way shapes, if not determines, your form, your structure. So if the subject of the modernist is fragmented, okay, if the subject of the modernist is ubiquitous, abstract, all that is solid melts into air, then the form or the structure must also be equally fragmented, okay, equally tenuous, okay, equally ubiquitous, okay. And so in that sense, equally free in that sense, because there are innumerable gaps, innumerable lacunas. So there is no dependable sentence structure anymore. There is vers liber, okay, or liberated verse, free verse, okay. There is no grammar as such, okay. Stanza pattern, rhyme, end rhyme or rhythm. So all these are kind of discarded for a more radical, more shocking kind of shocking mode of representation. Because the idea was the reality itself was shocking. Okay, reality itself was unbecoming. So this is a new reality, the post-industrial, post-urban reality, marked by class consciousness, marked by various kinds of departures from traditional ways of thinking in terms of women's movement, in terms of working class movement, anti-imperial or anti-colonial movements all across the entire world. Look, and all these things, all these movements are gathering steam in the second half of the 19th century, towards the end 19th century. So reality was in a way haywire. Okay, so it was. Reality itself was kind of outside one's control. You could not possibly control things anymore. Reality was decentered, so things were falling apart. Center could not hold anymore, as Yeats told us. So the idea of falling apart, So all these things, okay, were being talked about in a different language, of course, since. I'm talking about the European context, the Euro-American context, since the mid 19th century itself. Okay, so this new reality, new post-industrial, new post-capitalist or heyday of capitalism or high capitalism. Okay, Marxists describe this. Eric Hobsbawm, the great Marxist historian, for example, talks about the end 19th century, late 19th century as the age of high capitalism. So age of high capitalism dehumanizes people. It is marked by various kinds of alienation. Marx talked about various kinds of alienation. So did Freud. So did the existentialist thinkers like Nietzsche and others. So there are various kinds of alienation: material alienation, spiritual alienation, social alienation, moral alienation, and so on and so forth. So all these darknesses, all these negativities in one sense, or all these kind of uglinesses, okay, needed to be done justice to in the new work of art. And clearly, since these realities were not really beautiful realities, they were in a particular sense ugly realities, unwholesome, unbecoming kind of realities, which are not kind of aesthetically pleasing realities, we need to create a work of art, okay, which would do justice to this kind of reality, which also must carry in that, or carry in it, a semblance of ugliness itself. So work of art, so just look at the paradox. A work of art, an aesthetic product, which must carry on, or which must carry in it an appearance or semblance of ugliness by means of sacrificing some of the traditionally accepted aesthetic categories or aesthetic prescriptions. Okay, so the whole idea of beauty started to change. What would be considered as beautiful earlier, okay, came to be replaced by another notion of the beautiful now. So the romantic notion of the beautiful did not stand scrutiny anymore. So this is a new beauty created out of ugliness, or beauty in ugliness. Now, it is precisely a new kind of beauty, new notion of beauty, which was anticipated by none other than Kant in his idea of sublimity. Remember? Okay, probably you are aware of this term, at least come across this term sublimity. Okay, sublimity. Not only Kant, the German philosopher, following him, Edmund Burke, the British philosopher, politician, socialist, etc. They were talking about the idea sublime is, in a nutshell, in one sentence, is a kind of beauty which is threatening. Okay, which is threatening, which gives us a sense, a hang of nothing less than death itself. And this death is not merely moral, spiritual death or metaphorical death alone. Okay, it gives us glimpses of physical death. So physical, the idea of terror, idea of horror. Okay, so terror, horror, ugliness. So all these negative, quote unquote, negative sensibilities, okay, crept into the new discourse of beauty. Clearly, they were anti-romantic in one particular sense. But of course, let us not indulge in any kind of generalization or homogenization, because we know that the Kantian sublime also played an important role in the romantic discourse as well. I'll not go into the detail of this aspect. But yes, so the aesthetic of ugliness was central to, or at least very crucial component in modernist aesthetics. So the form did not want to entice you anymore. The structure, the subject matter did not want to please you anymore. Okay. So the function of poetry changed. Function of criticism changed. Function of the work of art changed. Okay. In the late 19th, early 20th century, it was not supposed to please you anymore. It was not supposed to aesthetically gratify you anymore. It was not supposed to kind of entertain or recreate you anymore in the sense of recreation. Okay, so that was not the role or goal or the objective of the modern or the modernist poet or the artist or the philosopher. Rather, the artist's role at one level was to shock you. The idea of shocking reality was shocking, and the work of art must be equally shocking. Shocking, why? Not merely to kind of threaten you, because threat, horror, terror, remember Gothic fiction in the late Romantic period, okay? So they also embraced these ideas, but that was not the end of the story, of course. This horror, terror, ugliness, scholar, so we know that, you know, I mean, those who have kind of at least cursorily gone through Eliot's poetry, so all these things are quite central to Eliot's poetry, Eliot's urban scape. So all these are to be represented to kind of shock you out of your stupor, to kind of to reawaken you, to 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 once more awaken you out of your slumber, okay, out of your slumber, slumber of unconsciousness, slumber of sleep. The assumption was that the entire Western civilization has reduced itself to ashes. It is asleep now. So some kind of reignition is required, and that's why, and so that the Western civilization can probably rise from the ashes like the proverbial phoenix. So that's why shock therapy is required. So non-pleasing but threatening work of art is the requirement of the day, is the order of the day. Clearly, this would reach its climax in the Brechtian idea of alienation, Brechtian idea of readerly alienation, that the role of the work of art is not to kind of entice the reader or draw the reader, attract the reader into its womb, not to allow the reader to identify with it, not to allow the reader to derive easy pleasure out of it, but to kind of try and shock the reader into awareness, to force him to be awake, okay, to force him to be conscious in all possible ways, politically conscious, culturally conscious, spiritually conscious. So this was the paradigm later on formulated in more concrete critical and theoretical terms by Bertolt Brecht in the late 1930s, early 1940s. But precisely the late naturalists in the late 19th century and the modernists were preparing the way for Brecht to reach this kind of discourse of poetry, beauty, aesthetics, social awareness, and so on and so forth. So clearly, there was ugliness everywhere. There was sleep, stupor, unconsciousness, passivity, wasteland, cactus land everywhere. In the external physical scape, okay, in the emergent landscape, the emergent urban landscape, and the inner scape of ordinary human beings and the authors alike. Because more often than not, that was marked by this idea of alienation, some kind of disintegration, alienation not only from society, not only from kind of satisfying, gratifying discourses like spirituality, God, dependable world order, and so on and so forth, progress, modernity, etc. But also more importantly, fundamentally, alienation from one's own self. So all these alienations inside and outside, in the external geographical scape and internal mindscape of people. So Freud talked about these alienations in the form of sexuality and violence. I mean, for Freud, sexuality and violence were the two most driving kind of factors, okay, driving forces in the human psyche. So these are some of the ideas, okay? These are some of the ideas. Obviously, I would like to go on at least for a couple of hours more to kind of set the stage for myself to move into Eliot's poetry. But that is obviously impossible because I've almost run out of time by now. So, but that is very cursorily, very, very superficially in a way, the backdrop, the all-round backdrop in which the modernists arrived or upon which modernists arrived and upon which they thrived. Okay. So the idea was that finally, that you cannot represent that reality with satisfaction. So all you can do is not to describe. The realists could describe. They could afford to describe because reality was knowable back then. But now that reality itself was intangible, abstract, ubiquitous, you cannot describe anymore. All you can possibly do is to kind of give glimpses of your awareness of that reality, which again is subject to your personal position. So it's a kind of many kind of displacements from authentic reality to go by the Platonic idea of multiple displacements or multiple kind of removals of or from the actual authentic reality. So you cannot describe. All you can possibly do to evoke. Evocation is about giving indications, giving glimpses and hints. It desists from making any certifying claim. It does not certify anything. So modernist literature in general, modernist art in general, modernist poetry in particular relies on evocation rather than description. It also says that, look, it is not possible for me to tell you anything. I cannot represent anything. All I can do is to formulate. So these were some of the fundamental changes in the ontological domain, that how we represent, how we know, okay, in the world of poetry and art, which were being brought about by modernism. So description was replaced by evocation and kind of certification was replaced by formulation. That I cannot certify anything, I cannot write down anything, I can copy or imitate anything. All I can do is to kind of formulate. Formulation is to jot down. So just as a series of jotted down materials or notes is not a kind of integrated whole, it's a kind of disjointed kind of entity. Likewise, the modernists at least aim at kind of giving their readers or their audiences a kind of very disjointed, non-comprehensive, very kind of formulaic or say this evocative kind of discourse, not knowledge of reality, which itself was very transitional, very ephemeral, very flimsy, very undependable. The idea is there was no ground of certainty beneath your feet, either in the world of reality or in the world of art anymore. Okay, so with this few and very inadequate, very superficial kind of introductory remarks, let me briefly read the three poems of T.S. Eliot as far as it would be possible within the given time limit. So, students, if you have the texts with you, please open Prufrock and other the Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock. This came out in 19. The poem was written between 1910 and 1912. Completed at around late 1911 and early 1912, but published in the famous journal of the time, Poetry, in 1915. So look, the poem was already completed. The composition of the poem was already completed before the First World War itself. So innumerable seminal or signpost like Brit Euro-American modernist texts were indeed composed well before the arrival of the First World War. The so-called originary point of the discourse of modernism in certain undependable critical accounts. So, and as I was telling you, that the idea of originality is impossible. It's all about tradition, or it's all about the kind of the individual's ability to locate himself or herself within the tradition. So all these poems of Eliot, like almost all other works of art produced by almost all artists in the period. So Eliot is not a kind of, not somewhat peculiar or somewhat special or exceptional over here. This is a modernist kind of framework. Okay, he is modernist this way. He is deeply symptomatic, deeply representative this way. Of course, retaining his individuality, his specificity or speciality in a particular manner. So Eliot's poetry is marked by a kind of very, very flabbergasting, very, very confusing, very intricate maze of intertextuality. So it is only a reader very well versed in the entire Euro-American tradition. And by tradition, I mean the way I was explaining tradition a little while earlier, not merely poetic tradition, but it is those people who know in a way, to put it this way, if you know what I mean, those who know Europe and America by their heart. It is probably only those people who can make probably quasi-adequate sense of these poems. Because again, as I just pointed out, adequate sense, finality of knowledge is as much impossible in the domain of readerly negotiation of the text as it is in the domain of the authorial interpretation of the reality outside the text. So innumerable intertextual references, networks, which is a kind of modernist hint at deliberate suicide, as if Eliot is trying to kind of, point to the reader, Eliot is trying to draw the reader's attention to the very fundamental fact that look at me, I'm T.S. Eliot, but I'm not original. I'm not an individual. Okay, I'm just a kind of product of a long Euro-American tradition. Without them, I am nowhere. Okay, so in a way, the author's sacrifice of individuality, again, a huge paradox. modernism following romanticism. Look, so yes, I mean, there are many things involved. Any one of them can take, say, at least 1 hour to do at least partial justice to them. So modernism is often perceived to be anti-romantic, not always. Modernism has a deep romantic strain about it. Maybe I'll make a remark or two on this when I read these poems. And secondly, following romanticism, modernists also believed in this value of the individuals, but at the same point of time, unlike the romantics, because of the clear temporal distance of more than 100 years, since romantics lived in a time where perception of an integrated individuality was still possible, and that was a matter of nostalgia, that was a matter that was passé. By the time we have reached the zone of the modernists in the late 19th, early 20th century, where individuality was perceived to be disintegrated, subjectivity was a matter of a superstition, and at best, when one can imagine subjectivity, one can do that only in terms of sexuality and violence, only in terms of ugliness. So that was a kind of revolting idea of individuality, which clearly is at clear disjuncture with the romantic paradigm. So romantics, probably your Wordsworths and Shelley's and even your Byrons would not probably think of individuality that way. This impure individuality, fallen kind of individuality, disgraceful individuality. So that's the paradox. On the one hand, modernists are deeply, radically individualistic, okay? And all they can swear by, okay? They sleep, they eat, they drink. So they all the individuality, I-ness, consciousness, individual human consciousness, and especially middle class male individual consciousness. That is yet another very problematic point. It is often claimed that modernism is about the modern day individual, but which modern day individual? Is it about the farmer in the remote village of Bankura? Is that individual the subject of the ideal subject of modernism? Or say an African woman, okay, I mean working her asses off in the remote hinterland of Kenya or Uganda or Nigeria, is it her subjectivity which is the object of representation by the modernist author? Certainly not. So let's not universalize things. This is not my point. Again, this point was made first by another important Marxist critic, Raymond Williams, in his Politics of Modernism. So let us locate modernism within a particular context, the late 19th, early 20th century, Christian, middle-class, Euro-American, male consciousness. That is the most important subject of the modernist preoccupation with individuality, or radical individuality or individualism. There are departures here and there. There is your Wolf, for example. There are a couple of other kind of departures, but that is the dominant discourse. But as we know, culture is made up of many discourses. Apart from the dominant discourse, alternative marginal discourses are always there. Again, it's a network. We must not reduce, we must not homogenize, but that is the dominant discourse. So yes, so that individuality or exploration of that individuality is central to the modernist paradigm. But at the same point of time, as I was talking about this paradox, okay, there is always this attempt at relinquishing any claim to individuality. One's attempt at taking recourse to the tradition, the discursive. So Eliot talked about the tradition, Foucault is talking about the discourse. Basically, the same thing in different language, but of course different in intensity as well. Okay, so one takes the logic of the other forward. So yes, so Eliot, as he tries to kind of draw the reader's attention to the fact that, look, I'm Eliot, but I'm nobody. Just ignore me, okay? Just ignore me. I'm nobody without the huge heritage of Euro-American culture before my back. So I'm carrying that heritage before my back, and that tradition makes me what I am. But at the same point of time, as he also points out, the individual also contributes towards shaping this tradition. So the tradition is not a static one either. It also changes its space, changes its form. So it's a kind of dialectic relationship between the individual and the tradition. So Eliot is there. His, quote unquote, his creativity, if there is anybody called his anymore, is definitely there. But at the same point of time, what is far more important is his intertextual, deliberate intertextual impulse. That means his voluntary sacrifice of his individual, of his claim to individual originality. As if he's trying to say that, look, without Dante, without Shakespeare, without many Elizabethan dramatists, without Jules Lafort, without Baudelaire, and without the metaphysical poets, and without many others, without Dickens, and so on and so forth. And this is only maybe a few among literally uncountable people who Eliot takes recourse to. So as if he says, look, without these people, I'm nobody. So it's obviously impossible to talk about any of them. I mean, all of them. But maybe I'll mention a couple of them in the course of my reading. So yes. So let us go then, you and I. When the evening is spread out against the sky like a patient etherized upon a table, let us go. To certain half-deserted streets, the muttering retreats of restless nights in one-night cheap hotels and sawdust restaurants with oyster shells, streets that follow like a tedious argument of insidious intent to lead you to an overwhelming question. Oh, do not ask. What is it? Let us go and make our visit. So the beginning is obviously deeply romantic, almost Uttam Suchitra kind of romantic. Ei pod jodi na shesh hoy. Let us go then, you and I. Okay. So there can be few kind of more romantic utterances than this. So at one level, this is deeply romantic, but at the same point of time, this romanticism also carrying it, its other deeply anti-romantic too. So edifices are built only to be shattered. Okay. Beautiful is built only to be kind of completely decimated by a kind of shocking revelation of ugliness a couple of sentences later, a couple of lines later. Let us go then, you and I. First of all, who is this you? Who is this I? We are talking about this you-ness and I-ness. Certainly not a man and a woman. Okay. Dedoublement, Jules Lafogue's dedoublement. I'll not talk about that right now. So the split personalities, fragmented selves within ourselves. The you is me, I is also me. Monore krishikar janona, amon manob jomin roilo poti tabad korle polto shona. That is the idea. So who am I talking to myself? Amar nijer moner kotha bolchi. O mon janona tomar ghore boshot kore koyjon. Ei je boshot kore koto jon, ei split personality golpo, that is central to the modernist framework. So Prufrock, the kind of typical individual European Euro-American middle class Christian white male. So that the rupture of the fracture is within himself. Let us go then, you and I. When the evening is spread out against the sky, like a patient etherized upon a table, a metaphysical conceit. Okay. So because various metaphors are kind of yoked by violence together over here. Okay. Like a patient etherized. Ether is the sky. Ether is also the what's this called? Jeta di ogyan kore dewa hoy, ota ki bole? Zakia? Hello?
Achi sir, achi. So much in trance.
Anesthesia. Anesthetic, yes.
Chloroform, sir.
Yes. So the anesthetic as well as the sky, the wide open sky, one deeply romantic and the other deeply unromantic. One talks about happiness and the other talks about disease existence. So what more incongruous coexistence yoked by violence together could one possibly think of? You know that Eliot was a great admirer of John Donne and company, the metaphysical poets. So the evening is spread out against the sky, beautiful imagery, almost romantic, deeply romantic. But then the evening is being likened with a patient. So what kind of evening is this? This kind of evening of the urbanscape of Boston, of Northern London. Okay, so the diseased existence of the modern Westland, but of course Westland would appear only in the late 1910s, early 1920s. This is way earlier, even before the First World War. So that evening is spread out against the sky like a patient etherized upon a table to be operated upon. So clearly, this is not the most romantic of scenarios to undertake a rendezvous. Okay. Let us go through certain half-deserted streets. So look, the reader's expectation is given a cruel and crude jolt. Okay. The Wordsworthian or Keatsian romantic kind of atmosphere is completely destroyed by the evocation of a crude, ugly, Baudelaire-like urban landscape. Okay. What? Let us go through certain half-deserted streets. Not completely deserted either. So there is always this ambivalence. Okay. There is no certainty. So what is like half deserted? It is something can be deserted or crowded, but it's half deserted. Okay. So this halfness it's always halfway through, neither here nor there. Hethanoi, onno kono khani. Again, ambiguity. It's about invocation or evocation rather than formulation. So let us go, evocation and formulation rather than description. I'm sorry. Let us go to certain half-deserted streets. The muttering retreats. So look, muttering. Again, muttering is half-speaking. Neither complete silence nor complete audible speech. So ei je dekho bar bar ghure ashbe ei ei ardheker kotha ebong ekhane ardhonarishwar image amra ektu pore peye jabo ei je ardhek halfway we are half alive half dead this metaphor is something which is deployed umpteen times okay in innumerable times in Eliot's entire corpus not only in this poem in many other poems the muttering retreats of restless nights for example the same landscape you will come across in the preludes restless the same images actually restless nights in one night cheap hotels so look the moral spiritual degeneration and Prufrock is located in that tradition so just as Eliot is a part of an inalienable part of the larger modernist and Euro-American long tradition so is Prufrock a part of the contemporary society restless nights in one night cheap hotels and sawdust restaurants with oyster shells so same imagery you will find in the preludes streets that follow like a tedious argument okay a boring monotonous kind of argument streets of insidious intent so invoking the serpent the proverbial serpent so the city street as serpentine the serpentine alleys by alleys lanes by lanes never ending I mean taking us nowhere without any destination so it's all about destiny no destination so those uncertainties darkness rottenness so all these things are invoked or evoked once again through these words streets that follow like a tedious argument of insidious intent insidious that is untrustworthy okay untrustworthy treacherous so this treacherousness okay untrustworthiness the breakdown of community friendship reliance so all these are part and parcel of the contemporary late 19th early 20th century Euro-American middle class urban experience so and again the moment the serpent is invoked obviously the Christian we cannot completely bypass the Christian imagery obviously I cannot go into any detail anymore to lead you to an overwhelming question so yes so just as look the question is everywhere okay the question is within Prufrock the question is within the reader because I mean when the poet says that some kind of argument or some kind of question is developing in the mind of the protagonist Prufrock like streets that follow like a tedious argument of insidious intent the reader feels that okay similar kind of questions are also being developed inside his or her psyche so reader becomes the Prufrock outside that text both are intrigued both are troubled by not only questions but also by the impossibility of reaching any satisfactory resolution or resolutions of those questions so Prufrock is inside the text Prufrock is outside the text we are all modern day Prufrocks so the text is delimited okay the text spills over the four sidelines of the page the character the protagonist the idea the reality so all those become part of ourselves so the question is building up the question is frothing within myself like a tedious argument of insidious intent to lead you to an overwhelming question so is this you again look at this play with you is one split self of Prufrock just as the you is the modern day reader an overwhelming question so look, the climax deliberately being built up but then there's kind of jolt again an anticlimax after the climax an anticlimax oh do not ask what is it so the question becomes suspended forget about the solution forget about the resolution even the question is not quite clear even the question is not quite clear we don't know the right questions to what to ask forget about the answers so Prufrock is confused perennially hanging perennially suspended just as most of us are dazed we are flabbergasted being we are dazed being we are hollow men we are stuffed men okay our headpieces are filled with straw, not by gray matter. That is the idea. So look how the author is at the same point of time, he's deeply condescending about the reader, because he is describing the reader as a bunch of blockheads that you cannot even think. You are dumb, you are silly, you are idiots. So look, this kind of distrust of the reader is again a very, very familiar modernist kind of skepticism about readership. Almost all modernist authors had this cynicism or skepticism about the readers, that they cannot understand me. Okay, so that I am not popular. We are ahead of times. So realist literature লোকেদের কি যেভাবে ওরা পড়তো আমাদের আর পড়ে না ভাবে কেউ আমাদের পাত্তা দিল না. So success, they wanted to be successful, but success eluded them forever. So yes, so they were deeply skeptical about the reader's ability. So was Eliot. So the proof rock himself is the reader. We are proof rocks, okay, and we all are basically a bunch of blockheads or idiots. To lead you to an overwhelming question, or do not ask, what is it? Let us go and make our visit. So just this tentative resolution is all. Let us go, that is it. But then again, we will realize a little later, even this resolution will not be kind of actualized. Okay, there are many New Year resolutions that we take, but hardly ever are they translated into actual concrete action. So proof rock is always in a limbo, much like Vladimir and Estragon in Waiting for Godot, which would come out at least 4 decades later. Okay, so how look, things are kind of combined in like an intertextual lens. Intertextuality is not merely the tradition that existed earlier, but also the tradition you create, tradition you anticipate, tradition that follows you. So Eliot's tradition is not merely Shakespeare's tradition, metaphysical poet's tradition, Dante's tradition and whatnot, but also the postmodernist writers' traditions, Foucault's tradition, Beckett's tradition, and many other writers' tradition. Tradition is not only a matter of past, but also a matter of future. That's exactly why Foucault wanted to understand tradition. So yes, so in the room, the women come and go, talking of Michelangelo. So again, this cynicism about women giving lip service to, providing lip service to great artists like Michelangelo, their degradation to ordinary glib talking Michelangelo. The women, these women are no less dumb. They do not know who Michelangelo are, and yet they claim to be kind of conversant with Michelangelo's art, and they kind of just pretend to know about him. So this kind of pretension, hypocrisy in women. So, but of course, and proof rock himself is as hypocrite as these women who he's skeptical about. So that hypocrisy would come out a little later in the poem. The yellow fog, look, the typical urban atmosphere, typical cityscape of Baudelaire, unreal city. Baudelaire talked about the unreal city, or the city of poisons, for Milan the city. So the city of poisons, okay? So poison, ugliness, so those are the things out of which Baudelaire created beauty. He created flower out of poisons, okay, flower of poisons. And his disciple, Eliot, seeks precisely to do that, creating beauty out of ugliness, creating the sublime out of the terrifying. The yellow fog, yellow, okay? The color of uncertainty, color of distrust, color of nastiness, color of ugliness, etc. The yellow fog that rubs its back upon the window panes. So look, so many associations, okay, come to be embroiled with each other, okay? The fog creates some kind of figure, a figure of a probably living being, an animate being, which rubs its back upon the window panes. The yellow smoke that rubs its muzzle on the window panes. So just look at the very metropolitan, industrial, very polluted kind of imageries, the Boston imageries, the North London, Liverpool kind of imageries. Licked its tongue to the corners of the evening, licked its tongue in the corner. So look, as I was saying, all that is solid melts into air, okay? So corners of the evening, okay? How can there be corners of the evening? The evening is not a kind of solid entity in any case, okay? It's an abstract entity. But the evening is kind of giving a kind of concrete shape, in a kind of reverse kind of exercise, by means of being given a concrete shape, the evening is further kind of abstractified in our consciousness. So we don't know what this evening is, how to make sense of the corners of the evening. But then again, nor is it the author's goal to help the author, help the reader to make any sense. All he does want to evoke some kind of sensibilities, evoke some kind of consciousness, evoke some kind of responses, not to give us any meaning. Modernist literature, modernist art, refuses to give in to any kind of reductive enterprise of meaning production. Art is not about meaning. Okay. Art is about aesthetics. So surplus is more important than the investment. So the art, real art, is a matter of the surplus, which transcends meaning. Okay. So it's not about meaning. It just is. It is not supposed to mean anything. It is just supposed to be. Okay. The work of art in the modernist paradigm is not supposed to mean anything. It is just supposed to be, to evoke some kind of sensibility. So one cannot say anything about this in that sense. But of course, one can say, of course, a lot of things about this, but I need 4 or 5 classes to talk about Prufrock alone. The yellow smoke that rubs its muzzle on the window panes, licked its tongue to the corners of the evening. So clearly, again, serpentine imagery, lingered upon the pools that stand in drains. So just look at the cityscape. Okay, let fall upon its back the soot that falls from chimneys, slipped by the terrace, made a sudden leap. Okay, a kind of feline imagery or serpentine imagery, all sorts of negative animal imageries. And seeing that it was soft October night, curled once about the house and fell asleep. So that's how the human consciousness functions. There is a snake, coiled in our psyche, a cat. Now, cat in the traditional imagination is a kind of untrustworthy kind of animal. But that is not really so in the Eliotian framework, because Eliot loved cats more than dogs. Okay. So again, ambiguous, again, ambivalence. Human consciousness, both lovable and poisonous, like a snake. And indeed, there will be time. So look, procrastination. As I was telling a little while earlier, there is no progress forward. Everything is in limbo. Everything is suspended. It's all about waiting for Godot or something else. Indeed, there will be time again. But for me, of course, there's no time anymore. I know that. I'll just sum up a little later. So, but of course, reminding us of Marvel. Marvel said, time's wing chariot hurrying near, but in a kind of reversal of Marvel's idea of time, Eliot says here, and indeed there will be time, etc. But for what? For the yellow smoke that slides along the street, rubbing its back upon the window panes, there will be time to prepare a face to meet the faces that you meet. Mukh dheke jai bigyapone, as Shankh Ghosh wrote many years earlier. So we do not meet human beings anymore. We meet prepared faces, all done up faces, all painted faces. Okay. So look, alienation from our own selves. Okay. And look, it's not merely about you meeting me in my painted up face, done up face. But more importantly, it's my you meeting my I, okay, with a done up face. That is, I don't know myself. I cannot trust myself. So that is the ultimate alienation that Marx talked about. Okay. Alienation from one's own self. Okay. You are not only alienated from people around you. There is not only a disintegration or breakdown in the society. More importantly, there is a breakdown, far more fundamental breakdown in your own self, in your own psyche. You do not know who you are. You do not know what you want. You have forgotten to come back to your center. We are all decentered beings. Okay. We are rootless beings. We are hollow men and women. Okay. We are kind of amra chhonno chhara shobai. Ajke juge somporke prochondo khate kotha ta. So the modernists kind of anticipate in many ways our own modern day hyper technological, hyper industrial, hyper consumerist kind of culture, where we have forgotten to kind of stop for a moment and think and get back to our center and remind ourselves in a calm and quiet manner. Monore krishika janona amon manob jomin roilo potit abad korle polto shona. Ei je kanna, ei je আমাদের এর মধ্যে ইটস নট মিয়ারলি অ্যাবাউট দ্য 20th century to 21st century alone. Okay, some of it is somewhat universal. Hamlet er moddhe etai chilo, Macbeth er moddhe etai chilo. They couldn't know themselves, they couldn't trace, they couldn't kind of they failed to make sense of themselves. Okay, but at least they do that. But for Prufrock, who would a little later say that I am not Hamlet, he would say, but of course inside his mind he considers himself to be a modern day Hamlet, like many of us. So again, there is a kind of there is a gap between, as Holloman, as in Holloman, the poet would say, there is a gap between what I say and what I mean. So there are so many gaps within myself, and so much so that I end up deluding not only people outside me but also deluding myself. I don't know what my other selves. So this idea of other selves would occur many times, both in Prufrock and in Preludes. What my other selves are, what my other selves want. So I am continuously busy preparing busy preparing faces to meet the faces that we meet day in and day out, when I am asleep, when I am awake, when I have dreams, when I have nightmares. I'm all busy, always busy to somewhat reconcile the ruptures, the fractures, the conflicts within myself. And my life, the entire life is spent in reconciliation. I cannot move forward in any kind of positive direction. I cannot move forward towards kind of reintegrating myself with the outside world, nature, my fellow beings, maybe God or some superior non-human entity or power or force, whatever. So tahole ki holo shesh porjonto? So it's a wasteland. I waste. ওই যেখানে শক্তি চট্টোপাধ্যায় বলেছিলেন না, প্রভু নষ্ট হয়ে যাই, আমরা সবাই নষ্ট হয়ে যাই, এই যে কান্না, এটা চিরন্তন মানুষের কান্না এক জায়গায়। ইটস এ ইউনিভার্সাল হিউম্যান প্যাং অফ এলিয়েনেশন, এক্সিস্টেন্সিয়াল ক্রাইসিস। বাট অফকোর্স দিস ক্রাইসিস অর দিস ক্রাইসেস কেম টু বি অ্যাকসেন্টুয়েটেড ইন আ কাইন্ড অফ ফার ডিপার ফ্যাশন, ফার মোর হরিবল ফ্যাশন, উইথ দি অ্যারাইভাল অফ দি হেডে অফ ক্যাপিটালিজম ইন দি লেট 19th আর্লি 20th সেঞ্চুরি। সো There will be time to prepare a face, to meet the faces that you meet. There will be time to murder and create. Yes, murder and create. Who? Me. Ideas and people outside me. We are continuously murdering and creating and recreating. We cannot rest. There is no stasis because we have lost confidence in our own selves. Okay, we don't know what to know. I mean, how to make sense of the world. So it's always a kind of making, then unmaking, then remaking. So continuously murdering, creating, recreating. So this is a game that continues. There is never a certainty. There is never a resolution of the problem. We are perennially suspended in the zone of unknowability. Okay, which has come to be somewhat banalized, come to be accepted as the human lot or human kind of condition. Okay, since the 1930s, 1940s, remember Somerset Maugham's of human bondage. This is the human bondage that he talked about. And later on, that came to be somewhat, quote-unquote, naturalized by the postmodernists in the late 20th century. So that lift and drop a question on your plate. So look, beautiful imageries. Obviously, cannot talk about all these things. Time for you and time for me, procrastination. And time yet for 100 indecisions. So yes, it's all about indecisions, okay? And for 100 visions and divisions. Look at the play with the word vision and division. Vision, formulation, what I see within myself. So various kinds of masquerades, okay, various kinds of nightmares or dreams inside me, the play of the human unconscious, human psyche, primarily violent imageries yoked together in our unconscious. So that is the vision, but those visions are not static, they're dancing visions. So they're combined, they're packed only to be unpacked in new combinations and permutations through new revisions before the taking of a toast and tea. So look at the anticlimax, a kind of brief evocation or a detailed evocation of the human crisis in the late 19th early 20th century, talking about human existential angst. After talking about human existential angst, all ends in nothing but taking a toast and tea. That is, everything is fashionable at the end of that. We talk about all these things only just to kind of but at the same time, wait for the end of this kind of tedious argument of insidious intent to stop and switch off my computer and to make my forays into the world of Facebook and WhatsApp and whatnot. So everything is fashionable at the end of the day. Even all these crises, all these angst, etc. These are mere kind of topics, questions. These are not kind of human realities for us anymore. These are topics and questions which have to be addressed for the forthcoming examinations. That's all. So how we kind of how desensitized we are. That is the idea. How alienated we are. Okay. How we have kind of stripped everything of their dignity. Okay. So we have forgotten to respect the respectable. So that is the idea. And the entire process starts from my own self. I have forgotten to respect myself. Respect the inner man, the bigger man, the larger man, probably the God within myself. That's why. That's the beginning of the crisis, as among many others, Tagore has taught us. Sorry, I'm really, really sorry. I apologize to you.
Sir, please. I think if we are not impinging on your time, sir, then it is completely fine. You could take your time. If we are not impinging on yours.
No, certainly not. But yes, I must...
We won't get this opportunity again and again. So, sir, you could please take your time if it is not a trouble for you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. But of course, I know that there must be some time. Not there will be time, there will be time. There must be some time for students yes. to kind of ask their questions. So, yes. So these are the things, again, take up, that would be taken up in the next poem, Preludes. I would have liked to talk about the entire poem had there been time on my side. And remember that Preludes was composed almost parallelly with Prufrock around the same time, 1910-12, and published in 1915, around the same time. So many of the images, ideas, metaphors, discourses, many of the self-castigations, a condescension upon the reader. So most of the important ideas overlap with this poem because they're composed around the same time with roughly the same mindset. So look, here also the same, winter evening. Winter. Look, there we found that the fog, the foggy winter evening was creating some kind of darkness, a mystery in the corner of the evening. And here also we find the winter evening settles down. Look, there is this continuous Eliotian preoccupation in this the early Eliot. There are two Eliots, the pre-Westland or pre-Holloman Eliot and the post-Holloman Eliot. Okay, when Eliot would convert from Unitarianism to Anglicanism in 1927. So 1927, the period from 1925 to 1927 was a kind of watershed moment in Eliot's career. So the pre-conversion Eliot, I mean, writes this kind of very depressing, very kind of despondent, kind of very negative kind of thought process. He's kind of deeply immersed in this ugliness, this darkness. And there are innumerable kind of similarities across his poems. So intertextuality is not merely between Eliot and other poets and artists within modernism, nor is it merely about modernists kind of interacting with pre-modernists and post-modernists in the chronological sense. It's also about the Eliotian creations, poems, plays, essays, etc. I could not mention many of them, of course, because of paucity of time. So that intertextuality is also there. So it where does it begin and where does it end? Nobody knows. So in all these pre-conversion Eliotian poems, which are deeply urban, deeply metropolitan, and this is not the glorious urbanity, okay? Glorious urbanity of some of the late 19th century French poets, okay? This is a negative urbanity, the underbelly of the city, the slums, okay? The unplanned growth, the suburbs of the city. So that somehow haunts not only Eliot, but many of the French and English modernists. So because probably all these imageries, all these cities were somewhat conducive to their kind of their notion of poetic or artistic creation, the creation of beauty out of ugliness. So ugliness was to be addressed. Ugliness could not be bypassed. Ugliness had to be negotiated. So in a way, that was a kind of inverted response to the romantic over preoccupation, over indulgence with beauty, a spontaneous overflow, powerful feelings and whatnot. So those banal ideas. The idea that life is not about beautiful, or jete ke Rabindranath bolben shubho mongol and what not, jibon shetai shudhu noy, life is primarily about its negativity. So again, that's a kind of, that's again another kind of excess, another kind of hyperbole. But yes, when people are within a moment, it's natural for them to transcend limits and to move into the domain of excess. কাজে পর তখন জলটা ঘোলাই থাকে, আস্তে আস্তে জলের মধ্যে নোংরা গুলো ফিপিয়ে পড়ে, ডিসিপেট করে, and the clean distilled water comes up later on. So they have the right to be quote unquote excessive in that sense. So one typical kind of imagery in many of these poems is that of the twilight, as I was talking about the ambivalence, knowledge and non-knowledge, certainty and uncertainty, crowdedness and desertedness, half deserted, muttering, see, speech and half speech. So this being trapped inside, trapped in nowhere, you are neither here nor there. Shedivche twilight zone, neither day nor night. In many of these poems, you would encounter this temporal framework where the poet is talking about the coming of the evening, slow coming of the evening, the sun setting down, darkness setting in, fog, the twilight zone, etc. So this twilight zone, the half light, half darkness kind of sensibility is quite kind of, it's a kind of what's this term that Eliot used, the external kind of metaphor to externalize certain internal human feelings and questions.
Hamlet. Objective correlative.
Thank you so much, Zakia. Objective correlative, yes. So this twilight is the objective correlative for Eliot in many ways. So the winter evening settles down in preludes. But notice the contrast. Preludes is about the beginning. But at one level, the evening is about the ending of that day, ending of light. But at the same point of time, doesn't the evening indicate some kind of beginning of nightlife? But nightlife in all its ghostlinesses, all its crookednesses, all its masquerades, okay, all its unholy excesses, enterprises. So those are the preludes. Again, it is not one prelude, but many preludes, okay. Look at the multiplicity, the heterogeneity of reality post-twilight in London, in the suburbs of London, suburbs of Boston and whatnot. The winter evening settles down, but at the same point of time, actually, there is no settling down. Again, the beginning is very, very twisted, consciously ironic, because it's all about unsettling, okay? It's all about the beginning of, first of all, restlessness for the people, which would unsettle the sane soul like that of the poet and like that of the many modern readers like us. How does it settle or how does it unsettle us? The winter evening settles down with smell of sticks in passageways. 6 o'clock. Look at the just brevity, conciseness, directness, much like the kind of jolt-like utterance. 6 o'clock. That's it. So this brevity of, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So look, I mean, this idea of pithiness, that you must say, that is another important modernist idea. You must not say anything unlike I am doing over here. I'm saying probably a lot more than I should. But the modernists believed in brevity, because the braver you are, not braver, braver. The more brevity you have, the more pithy, the pithier you are, the more punch you pack in your fist. That is the idea. So you must be as concise, precise, as to the point as possible. So that would be far more penetrating, far more irritating for the reader. 6 o'clock, as straightforward, like a bullet, as a tracer bullet. The burnt out ends of smoky days. Look at the diction. So we have been talking about the themes, but the form is also very important. The burnt out ends of smoky days. How terse, how pithy, how monosyllabic all these words. Look, the winter evening settles down. So how cut, each and every one of them. How clear, okay? And the dominance, predominance of hard syllables other than soft syllables, the burnt out ends of smoky days, okay? Now, again, metaphysical concept, a day is imagined compared with a cigarette. And the end of the day, the day's end is being compared with the butt end of the cigarette, which is to be thrown away by the smoker. So another wasted day, it's to be thrown away. So the day failed to add anything constructive, anything resourceful to the repository to our life. It is just another cigarette, okay, which just probably contributed a little bit of smoke, little bit of nicotine to our already kind of darkened lungs. So that's all that days contribute to our life today. The burnt out ends of smoky days, smoky cigarette, as well as the factory chimneys in North London, the smoke emanating city altogether, because as the poet says, the smell of steaks in passageways, restaurants, bars, street joints open around this time during the twilight. So smoke is the order of the day around the time in London. So things become smoky physically as well as metaphorically. Things become shrouded in mystery. It's a mystery zone, okay? So temporally as well as spatially. Now a gusty shower wraps the grimy scraps of withered leaves about your feet. So just once more, look, mostly monosyllabic words, the deeply cutting, deeply wounding monosyllabic words are predominant. Now a gusty shower wraps the grimy scraps of withered leaves. So a sudden shower, sudden gust of shower. Okay, grimy, look, oh, once more, ugliness, clumsiness, clayed jake bole, the grimy scraps of withered leaves. So withered leaves, dead leaves, yellowing leaves, not life but death, okay, about your feet, and newspapers from vacant lots. Now the vacant lots in many senses, vacant slums and the vacant lots of human beings, that's vacant fortune, vacant fate. We don't have anything in store for us in near future, as long as or as far as we can see. The future stretches like a kind of never-ending desert, as in the wasteland. So the future, he's trying to become somewhat prognostic about the future of the modern day West. So again, look, the romantic, because the romantic poets wanted to be the, as Shelley put it, the unacknowledged legislators of the world. So the poets wanted to be the seers, the visionaries of the world. So Eliot wanted to play that role, probably wants to play that role here. He wants to kind of imagine or tell us about what probably lies ahead or does not lie ahead. Newspaper from vacant lots, the showers beat on broken blinds and chimney pots. At the corner of the street, a lonely... So look, innumerable images. So it's all about a series of images, clumsy images, okay? None of them quite bright, none of them quite cheering or cheerful. So everything is so very depressing. Everything is so very disjointed. And they add up to not a kind of clear, conjoined, wholesome, total picture. It's like a collage. Just like a collage is a combination of a series of disjointed images which do not create any kind of unified significance, unified meaning. And yet, in spite of this inability, or in spite of the willing suspension of belief, it ends up creating something, some kind of sensibility, ends up invoking or evoking some kind of sensibility in us. In other words, it evokes sensibility in spite of not meaning or telling us anything. Likewise, these lines also probably ends up ringing certain bells in our heart, in our consciousness, in our intellect, in our psyche, without telling us anything clearly. Because telling is knowing, which is impossible. All we can do is to formulate, is to evoke. So at the corner of the street, a lonely cab horse steams and stamps, and then the lighting of the lamps. Yes. So there's a dramatic quality about this. So, and probably the idea is, after all this smoke and lack of clarity, lack of vision, disjointedness, evocation. Probably there are moments, at least in the lives of some of us, where we have certain visions of reality. That is precisely a line. That's a certain epiphany, a certain knowledge, certain unprecedented knowledge of what is. So look, knowledge is real knowledge. Vision, epiphanic knowledge is cut off from history, doesn't have any history. You cannot predict it. Okay. Wisdom, when it will be blessed upon you, nobody knows. You also don't know. It just comes all on a sudden. It does not have any history, nor does it have any future or legacy. So light lamps in some of us, karun karun de bodhi chole ashe hotat. So there is grimy scrape, there is shower, there is cloud, there is smoke, there is darkness, there is twilight everywhere. Kintu, after all these things, there are moments when there are certain realizations too, certain enlightenments too, which you cannot anticipate, which you cannot prepare for. AJ, so this idea of alternative knowledge, ahistorical knowledge, that is another important aspect of modernism. Epiphany is something which was talked about Henry James, James Joyce, Virginia Woolf, Eliot, among others. So this vision would be talked about in the second last stanza of the poem. I am moved by fancies that are curled around these images and cling. The notion of some infinitely gentle, infinitely suffering thing. So that kind of vision. But then again, so yes, then night, the morning comes to consciousness of faint, stale smells of beer. So staleness, morning sickness. So the night life of the city, the bars and the restaurants, rampant entertainment, etc. So the ennui, the exhaustion, the tiredness. Morning begins not with freshness for us, for most of these modern middle-class individuals. Morning begins with a sense of exhaustion, sense of tiredness of life, not a sense of anticipation of something good, but a sense of apprehension of something bad. Probably, I mean, again, there is an excess, obviously a kind of negative mindset involved here, but this is not completely kind of unrepresentative even today, even in the early 21st century. So, before ending, let me briefly, for 2-3 minutes, I move to the next poem, which came out in 1925, where it's Hollow Men. In Hollow Men, there is a continuity of these ideas to a great extent. And let us remember that just as Preludes was composed parallelly with Proof Rock, the Hollow Men, which came out in 1925, 10 years after both these poems, was composed parallelly with the arguably the most famous poem of Eliot and most famous, arguably, most famous or notorious English poem, The Westland, which was composed in the late 1910s, early 1920s, and came out in 1922. And this hollowness of men is the subject matter of this poem. We are hollow men. This pessimism, this melancholia, this skepticism is part and parcel of the entire Eliotian corpus before his conversion. But of course, this is the twilight zone, hollow men in Eliot's poem, Eliot's poetry, not poem, Eliot's poetic career, because this would also mark some kind of change in vision. Because after a lot of groping in darkness, probably he has found some kind of certainty in his life, probably in Christianity, probably in Anglicanism. So therefore, from now on, from the Westland onwards, the Bible, okay, and the biblical narratives would be the biggest source of his intertextual inspirations in his poetry. Earlier, the entire, secular European tradition, but from now on, from Westland onwards, it is mainly the Bible and at times even the Eastern Buddhist, Hindu, Islamic texts, religious texts, which enrich Eliot's poetic imagination at this point of time. So this probably signify a new Eliot in germination, and which would not come into fruition as such, but which would come into prominence in later dramas like Murder in the Cathedral, some later poems too, really. Choruses from the Rock and Journey of the Magi and so on and so forth. So this religiosity, this metaphysicality would probably give him some kind of consolation, would give him some kind of rest that would allow him some kind of transcendence. This transcendence is somewhat indicated at, hinted at in The Hollow Men, probably the last Eliotian poem, last major Eliotian poem before his conversion. So in that sense, this is a poem of transition, where the earlier Eliot is still very much there. In fact, that is still the dominant Eliot, but the emergent, more hopeful, more cheerful, more Christian, religiously oriented Eliot is peeping from darkness in this poem, is emerging. That's an emergent discourse here. So we are the hollow men. We are the stuffed men. So clearly, a continuation of the earlier pessimistic kind of sensibility, leaning together, headpiece filled with straw. Alas, our dried, so everything is dried, everything is dead. So similarities with the Westland and many other poems, a whole lot of intertextual allusions are there. I cannot go into that now. So one, our dried voices, when we whisper together, look, earlier he was muttering, his protagonist was muttering, now he's whispering. That's the only change. So our dried voices, when you whisper together, are quiet and meaningless. So the idea of meaninglessness is again very much there. As wind in dry grass of rat's feet over broken glass in our dry cellar. Again, so this nighttime orgy involving drinking, merrymaking, restaurant, sawdust sprinkled restaurants with oyster shells, one night stands, something that happened in Proof Rock. So that atmosphere continues here too, and the cellar is expectedly quite dried up. So we have reduced ourselves, clearly Westland, shape without form, shade without color, probably the most classic poetic statement of the Marxist idea of alienation within me. I have shape, but I don't have any form. I am shade without color, okay? Pale, colorless beings, okay? I've lost my color, lost my life, lifelessness, bloodlessness. So paleness, shadeness, but no color. Paralyzed force, a patient etherized upon a table to be operated on, like Proof Rock, like Dazed. Who can mutter, who can procrastinate, who cannot decide, who cannot resolve. So paralyzed force, gesture without motion. So many beautiful dyads, gesture without motion. So we can kind of probably initiate certain movements, but we cannot carry that forward with any kind of gusto, with any kind of any kind of dedication, any kind of resolution. That is somewhat missing here. So we are trapped between motion and stasis. Not to be or not to be, that is the question, the perennial Hamletian problem. Here to do or not to do, to move or not to move, to progress or not to progress, that is the question. In fact, that is the question, to progress or not to progress. That was the biggest question that was paralyzing, that was gripping the sensible and conscientious, politically, metaphysically, poetically conscious and conscientious, sociologically conscientious, social leaders, religious leaders, metaphysical leaders, poets, thinkers alike in the late 19th, early 20th century Europe and America. Whither are we? To progress or not progress? I mean, what is progress? To be modern or not to be modern? To move ahead or to stop for a moment and think? So this idea of progress was most beautifully captured by the German Jew thinker Walter Benjamin in his idea of civilization, idea of history in Illuminations, where he's talking about progress or modernity as a project. Habermas, the later postmodernist thinker, would be talking about this progress or modernity as an incomplete project. So this incompleteness of modernity was being apprehended by or comprehended to an extent by the late 19th century conscientious people. And Benjamin said that, look, this modernity is a kind of tragic kind of phenomenon. Progress is always a tragic kind of phenomenon, which is not only futuristic, but also nostalgic. It continuously looks back at the past. So modernity's chariot, the chariot of progress, not only moves ahead with rampant diabolic speed, at times, at the same point of time, it retains a hunger, retains a desire for the past. Okay, so progress is therefore, or modernity is a kind of Janus-faced entity. Janus-faced, to use that kind of classical image, Greek classical image, Janus-faced entity, which is futuristic as well as nostalgic. We look forward to future, but at the same point of time, there come points when we stop for a moment and think and look back in anger, in frustration, in wistfulness to our past. So the prospects of what we can gain probably inspires us to indulge in this kind of endless race, at times rat race or otherwise. But at times there come moments when we stop and think, whither are we? Ki hobe? So what is about all this? Why all this race, this reckless kind of movement, futuristic movement, this reckless use of technology, modernity, progress? So what is the significance of all this? Can all this make us any happier? Can all this make us any less alienated? Can all this help us make friends in our locality, in my country, across humanity? Can all this help us any more human or humane? So these are the questions that started to kind of trouble many of the thinkers, many philosophers, and ordinary men, common people like us too, during the heyday of modernity, progress, technology, science, capitalism, that is the late 19th, early 20th century. So that was the ultimate question, gesture without motion. So should we progress or should we stop? Should we kind of join the bandwagon of this homogeneous, dominant discourse of Euro-American modernity, which Europe and America themselves have started to turn somewhat skeptical about since the late 19th century itself? In fact, Romanticism was itself, in a sense, an anti-modernist discourse. So was modernism. Modernism itself was anti-modernist in the sense that it challenged some of the dominant discourses in the European discourse of modernity. So both Romanticism and modernism tried to draw our attention to some of the loopholes of the dominant discourse of Euro-American modernity. Help us raise certain very important questions about the incursions of the inhuman discourse of modernity. It wanted to kind of rethink the idea of progress, our discourse of progress, and it wanted to kind of probably reintegrate us with some of the undervalued, but at times much more respected aspects of our life, like nature, like the non-human animalistic life, the eco life of the cosmos, of the universe, and say the feminine sensibilities as opposed to the aggrandizing hyper-masculine sensibilities of technology, science, and modernity. It wants to draw our attention to the human unconscious, the subconscious, the illogical, the non-rational, which were kind of suppressed under the aggrandizing wheels of the chariot of modernity. So they wanted us to stop, question the pathologies of modernity, and wanted us to rethink ourselves, reconstitute ourselves, and de-alienate, reintegrate ourselves. Eliot's poetry, therefore, as a whole, in a sense, obviously, I'm sorry, I could not do more than I could do. I'm more than sure. I'm happy to kind of concede that I could do very little, almost nothing. But Yes, in a sense, Eliot's poetry kind of, also Yeats's poetry, among other modernists, teach us to raise questions about the dominant Enlightenment discourse of modernity, and thereby to ask questions about our own modern day habitus, everyday life, not only in the Euro-American context, but also in the modern day Indian context as we are living it. It is probably only this way, Eliot to make him our own, that we can do justice to Eliot's poetry, not by reducing him, obviously, anybody else, any of these great masters, creators, to mere exam questions or syllabus topics. Thank you very much. All your questions first.
Thank you, sir. I am actually falling short of words to thank you right now. You have far exceeded our demands, sir. I mean, we approached you for just a mere text, anything of your choice, but I think your lecture was an entirely a prelude in its own to at least two entire papers that a semester five students have. I don't know from where to start thanking you, so I would rather ask my head, our professor Madhumita Das madam, to speak a little on this. It means I'm so taken in the trance still, and I so hate to break the spell. There are no words to thank you, sir. I mean, the way you have charted your way from enlightenment to the very verge of post-humanism, and the way you touched upon the poems with so many discourses that you have gone through, aesthetics, the theories of aesthetics, so many theories, strands of theories. I think it's just not something to...
Is there any problem? Hello? I can video on kora. Hello?
Ma'am, Zakia is facing a bit of network issues, and perhaps our resource person is also facing certain issues. I'm trying to let them in. Okay. I'm trying to log in through okay. Our different account.
Okay.
Just I ask for 1 or 2 minutes.
Okay, no problem.
হ্যাঁ বলছি। না করে দিয়েছিল, হ্যাঁ সৌরভ স্যার করা হয়ে গেছে, কিন্তু আসেন কিন্তু স্যার। হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে।
Is sir here? Sir, join. Yes, sir is here. I'm so sorry, sir. Again, a technical glitch without which we perhaps cannot do. Sir, could you hear me? আবার মিটিং এর ইয়ে হয়ে যাবে। স্যার, ক্যান ইউ হিয়ার আস? Sure.
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello, can you hear me, Zakia?
I think, ma'am, can you hear him?
Yes.
Yes, sir, I can hear you, sir.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
So sorry for this entire technical glitch, sir. Some things which we can't avoid. Madam, please say, I think you were to say.
Okay.
MD ma'am?
Okay. Good afternoon, Dr. Dash Thakur. I take this opportunity to be introduced to you personally. I really learned a lot from your in-depth theoretical deliberation followed by textual analysis. So saying formal thanks, I think, will be too ignoble. I'm literally grateful and overwhelmed to observe your passion for teaching also. I believe the students must have been immensely benefited by your lecture. And let me tell you, I hope to invite you, sir, once again when normalcy is restored. Have a good day ahead and God bless you, sir. Okay, Zakia, over to you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Madhumita Di. Can I call you Madhumita Di?
Hope I can. Why not? You are all junior.
Thank you very much for your kind words. I'm not very sure I was of much help to students. I tried to kind of do, I mean, as well as I could probably.
So you would embarrass us by saying that.
না স্যার, আমি একটু বাংলাতেই বলছি আমি রবীন্দ্রনাথের কথা একটু বলি, যে সবই এক্ষুনি বুঝে ফেলতে হবে তা নয়। ওরা যা সংগ্রহ করলো সেটা ওদের সংগ্রহে থাক, এখন কি না হয় 50% যদি বুঝে থাকে আর 50% না বোঝা অবস্থায় ওদের খাতায় থাকে বা মাথায় ধরে রাখার চেষ্টা করে, ইন কোর্স অফ টাইম আই থিংক ইট উইল give them a benefit. সুতরাং সবই এক্ষুনি বুঝতে হবে তা নয়, আমরা কেউ তো বুঝে শুনে বা শিখে আসি না, থাকতে থাকতে শিখি, বসবাস করতে করতে শিখি।
ঠিক, হ্যাঁ, থ্যাংক ইউ, ইয়েস,
থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ।
আচ্ছা, আই উড নিড অহনাদি'স হেল্প টু কালেক্ট দ্য কোয়েশ্চনস, যেহেতু আমি মিটিং এ রিজয়েন করেছি অহনাদি, আমার চ্যাট বক্স আর কোনো কোয়েশ্চন নেই, কিন্তু দুটো জিনিস আমি বলবো। স্যার, দেয়ার ওয়ার কমেন্টস ফ্রম টু অফ মাই কলিগস, অভিষেক চৌধুরী, অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর, ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ ইংলিশ, আগ্রা কলেজ। হি কমেন্টেড অন ইয়ার থিওরিটিক্যাল ব্যাকগ্রাউন্ড, দ্যাট আই মিন অল অফ আস আর মোর দেন ইনডেটেড টু ইউ ফর দ্য ব্যাকগ্রাউন্ড ইউ চার্টেড ফর আস। And there was Navanita Paul, she's also a member of our department. She also commented on the entire lecture as very intriguing. As per the questions of the students, Ohanadi, please, if you could go on.
So the first question we have from Viraj of 5th SEM. He asks, sir, as we know that Eliot, in a sense, admires the organic and spiritual community of the Middle Ages, together with his impersonal concept of art and some characteristics of his work, exhibit medieval themes and styles. So how much it would be appropriate to consider T.S. Eliot as medieval modernist? It's a big question.
I'm not very confident about this phrase, this sobriquet, medieval modernist. What does this mean? I'm not very sure about that. I mean, it's not only about Eliot, but all poets always draw their inspiration from earlier aesthetic paradigms, earlier traditions. Because that is the way, first of all, modernists looked at the whole idea of artistic creativity itself. And that is something not exclusive to modernists alone. Everybody else has to draw on the earlier tradition, earlier materials. So Eliot happened to kind of look back at medievalism, Greco-Roman, classical European heritage and other things. But that does not make him especially what this person calls medieval modernist, any more than you can probably call Shakespeare a kind of a classical Renaissance writer. Okay, without the European classical period, we cannot imagine Shakespeare. But does that make Shakespeare a classical Renaissance writer? I'm not very sure about this. But I mean, how does that matter? The rose is always a rose. These nomenclatures don't really matter, at least so far as my understanding of Eliot is concerned. He's a modernist and he draws on many other earlier traditions, including medievalism, but certainly not the only phase of Euro-American history or heritage that he clings on to. Okay, he draws on many other periods. So we don't need to kind of indulge in this kind of very, very, very determining, very, very deterministic or very reductive kind of nomenclatures. That's my take on the question.
Oh, so the next question we have from Piali of fifth semester. She asks, is T.S. Eliot's poetry associated with the modern theories of cubism and futurism, or is there any reference of cubism and futurism in his poetry?
There are many. Yes. In fact, there is this reference to descending down the stairs, okay, in one of these poems. And this descending down the stairs would at one level would remind us of Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, okay, when Raskolnikov descends down the stair to murder a woman. At the same point of time, it might remind us of the 1912 painting of Marcel Duchamp, the nude descending down the staircase, which was a famous quasi-cubist painting. And there are many other references too, and futurism too. Futurism too kind of appears in many of Eliot's poetry, and of course Eliot's drama too. Yes, but not only cubism and futurism alone, many other European, primarily French, Italian movements that took off in the late 19th century, sub-movements, and others in the early 20th century, they leave their imprints in Eliot's creative corpus. In fact, this is one very important aspect of... Hello? Yes. This is one of the many important aspects of modernism. I could not touch upon this aspect. This believes in the traffic of ideas across art forms. And this is one of the many kinds of intertextualities that modernism indulged in. So it's not merely kind of traffic between one literary work and another, Eliot talking about John Donne or Shakespeare or people like them, but traffic between various kinds of art, literature and painting, literature and music, or say painting and cinema. So all these various kinds of traffic to create a kind of integrated world of arts that was yet another important kind of feature of the modernist enterprise. So yes, indeed, cubism and futurism in particular, and many other literary sub-movements, aesthetic sub-movements in the late 19th century Europe did find a very important place in Eliot's imaginative views.
Right, the next question is from Otto Nu of fifth semester. I'm shortening up the question. He asks, Baudelaire's sense of morbid self-consciousness and distressful life of city felt a great impact also. Then Eliot gradually became, since I'm shortening it up, Iliad gradually became a sensitive commentator of unreal city. Iliad uses city as a metaphor of troublesome city, life of city. So would you please comment a little bit on this topic? Though I feel this has been already addressed by Sir in his lecture. So this is the question.
Yes, I've already briefly talked about this in this lecture. Eliot was a great admirer of Baudelaire. So his idea of city as poisoned, his idea of his preoccupation with the underbelly of the late 19th century Paris, Parisian city, underbelly, the Paris suburbs, the darker aspects of the city haunted Baudelaire, the poisoned aspect of the city. That probably kind of carried an echo in his mind of the, as this student has rightly pointed out, the morbid self-consciousness of the modern, alienated, isolated, middle-class European man in the late 19th, early 20th century. So at the same point of time, let us also remember that it has been often argued, or as opposed to the accusation made by this group of poets, Baudelaire, Eliot, and many others, that they rejoice in this kind of darkness, okay? That they celebrate this kind of poisonality, or poisonousness, or the clumsiness, the darkness, the ugliness of the city. As opposed to subscribing to this kind of argument, I would rather like submit that both Baudelaire and following him Eliot wanted to kind of hold a looking glass, hold a mirror, okay, to the Western alienated, progress mad, modernity mad, middle class man in the late 19th, early 20th century, to show him his real face. They wanted to make them ask questions about their own identity, about their own entity, the kind of muck that they were trapped in the name of modernity, progress, civilization, technology, empire, science, certainty, arrogance, and whatnot. So this muck is not for muck's sake. This poison is not for poison's sake. They did not want to celebrate all these things. They did not want to celebrate morbidity, celebrate pessimism, or darkness, or skepticism, or alienation, or cynicism, as it has been often argued by second-hand or third-hand critics. Rather, modernism wanted to kind of sublimate these things. They wanted people to kind of sublimate, in the Freudian sense, sublimate all these kind of morbidities within themselves through the creation of beauty. They wanted to turn the ugly into the beautiful. This is the role that sublime wanted to play. Kantian sublime, or the Barkian sublime wanted to play. So, by means of indulging in poisonousness, indulging in the mud, the grime, the muck, etc., they wanted to kind of overcome that muck or defeat that muck. So it is only probably by means of negotiating with reality, no matter how negative it is, that you can kind of overcome that reality or win over that reality. There is no point. There is no way you can bypass it. So when the reality is fragmented, you have to face it. So you cannot just turn a blind eye to the deteriorating, degenerating reality around you in the name of beauty, art, aesthetics, romanticism, and whatnot. So if the reality is ugly, you have to face it, you have to negotiate it. And if it is possible, you have to create beauty out of it and thereby sublimate yourself. Create the beautiful out of your own self. So another important concept comes to my mind in this context. Foucauldian idea of self-making, the aesthetics of the self. So it is not merely about the muck, the mud, the grime is not merely there in the outside scape, cityscape, the physical geographical cityscape. More importantly, it's there inside you. The muck is inside you and outside you. The city is degenerated, deteriorated, poisonous, so are you. So, আমাদের নীলকণ্ঠ হয়ে উঠতে হবে, ওই পয়জনটাকে আমাদের খেয়ে সেখান থেকে সেটাকে জয় করে উই হ্যাভ টু আর্ন বিউটি। সো উই হ্যাভ টু কাইন্ড অফ রিমেক আওয়ারসেলভস, এস্থেটিসাইজ আওয়ারসেলভস বাই মিন্স অফ অ্যাড্রেসিং দ্যাট পয়জন দ্যাট উই হ্যাভ অলরেডি সোয়ালোড। সো দ্যাট ইজ প্রোবাবলি দ্য বোদলেয়ারিয়ান, দ্য আলটিমেট বোদলেয়ারিয়ান অ্যান্ড এলিয়টিয়ান কাইন্ড অফ অ্যাটিটিউড টুয়ার্ডস দ্য পয়জনাস সিটি অর দ্য আনরিয়াল সিটি। উই হ্যাভ টু মেক দ্য পয়জনাস বিউটিফুল অর দি পয়জন থেকে আমাদের অমৃতে চলে যেতে হবে এন্ড উই হ্যাভ টু মেক দ্য আনরিয়াল সিটি দ্য রিয়াল সিটি ফর আওয়ারসেলভস ইয়েস
Are there any more questions? Anandi?
Yes, there are questions. There are more questions.
Okay.
The next two questions are from Probahu and Piali of 5th SEM. And since they're both from tradition and individual talent, I'm like speaking them out together. Probahu asks, Sir, while discussing about Eliot's notion about tradition, you mentioned the term visual tradition. Would you please throw some light over the term a little bit? And Piali asks, while dealing with the concept of tradition, Eliot said it's not simply the pastness of the past, but it's present that is important. Sir, can you please explain the line in a nutshell? These are the two questions, sir.
I've talked about both these things during my speech, but to again explain briefly, visual tradition, the tradition of visual art in Europe and America. For example, Renaissance painting, those are Van Gogh and other people, romantic painting, landscape painting like Constable and others, early 19th century painting, late 19th century realist painting, and of course the Futurists, the Cubists, and other early modernists or proto-modernists in the fag end of the 19th century. So that was the long Euro-American tradition of visual arts that I kind of try to signify in this small phrase, visual tradition. That is one thing. And so far as the pastness of the past and the present of the past, that is also I talked about in my brief discussion, the idea of tradition, that the past is never a complete radical past. It carries on as a part of ourselves, okay? So we carry the past, and in the fact of us carrying the past remains a present. The past is not merely a matter of our forefathers, our foreparents, our foremothers alone, okay? We carry past within ourselves. So past is a matter of past. And by the same logic, it extends itself to the present, to the future too. So pastness of the past needs to be understood as a kind of limited sense. We also need to understand the presentness and not only the futureness of the past. So that is one important indication of the inventions or new paradigms in understanding time in the modernist framework. I did not have the time to touch upon all these very interesting ideas. Realists talked about chronological time, okay? A kind of seamless, straightforward chronological movement. I mean, the idea of causation, causative movement from the past to present to future. While modernists quite rejected this idea of pastness of past, and they said that time is more circular than linear and chronological. Past is not only a matter of past, past is also a future. And even our future can lead us in a kind of particular sense to our past. So we live not only in present, but we live in all these three times together, past, present, future. So it's a kind of nest of time. Shomoyer nir, jetake Rabindranath bolchen. We live in a nest of time comprising all these various threads of time. We do not live in a kind of temporal present, which is just a kind of consequence, which follows the past and which anticipates the future. That's the wrong kind of idea. Time cannot be divided into these three clear categories. Time is one. This is one time. It is one time. And therefore, one can find not only spatial disjointedness in the modernist texts, but also kind of temporal kind of disjunctions. So they always move out, they deal with, they juggle with various times and various spaces at the same point of time, because for them, all times are one time, all spaces are one space together. We live in various places and various times at the same point of time.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Joita of 5th SEM. She asks, would you please describe T.S. Eliot's surrealistic approach and the stream of consciousness technique in his poems?
This question would demand another class, actually. I'm tired, in fact.
Exactly.
Yes, surrealism, even magic realism, why not? Okay, in many senses, surrealism... Look, the basic thing is, I have talked about stream of consciousness. I briefly invoked interior monologue. And both these ideas can actually be kind of bound together and trace back to one fundamental problem, the new understanding of reality, what reality is. Okay. So there are departures. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry for interrupting. Actually, these questions come half through the session. So you definitely have touched upon all of them, but probably our students questioned you beforehand.
True. I understand. That's quite natural. So yes. So there were questions about the nature of realism, as I briefly talked about, during the late 19th century. So the dominant 19th century chronological, objective, scientific discourse of realism, empirical, verifiable discourse of realism, was replaced by many alternative notions of reality in the late 19th century. One was surrealism, one was magic realism. So in many ways, in various ways, they are kind of pointing towards the idea of psychological reality, that reality is more in the consciousness than in the outside world. Amari chetunar rongi panna holo shobuj chuni utlo ranga hoy. Paji, ami dekhi boli shobuj ta shobuj. Ami toke lal dekam shita lali hoto. So so I cannot go into any greater detail on this, but so this kind of pluralization of reality, the idea that the reality we usually take and describe as reality is only the superficial, the outward version of reality. That is not reality at all. That's a maya, illusion. Plato, as Plato told us, je ota to reality noy jeta amra dekhi. The reality of senses, our five senses, is only the shell, the outer shell of your reality. Actually, that's a kind of deceptive appearance of reality. We need to kind of penetrate the veil of that appearance to really formulate, to have an idea of what that reality is, that reality is inside. So unfurling appearance and seeing fire inside. So as Plato told us, and as Indian Upanishadic philosophers also told us, that we need to go beyond the world of Maya. We need to kind of know other realities. So these are this other reality is kind of unspecified. Various schools have described that other reality, that other zone of reality, because that's a twilight zone. It's neither complete light nor complete darkness, neither here nor there. So surrealists take that reality in one way. Magic realists describe that reality in another way. The cubists, the vorticists, they all have their various ways of representing that reality or capturing or kind of conceptualizing that reality. So there is no certainty about these things. But the point is, yes, Eliot did create a kind of surrealist atmosphere in many of his poems, including the ones that we have very briefly, very, very superficially, very perfunctorily just had the time to touch on, and stream of consciousness or interior monologue. I talked about briefly, did not have the scope to. Jules Laforgue, another important French poet, from whom he took the idea, he borrowed the idea of interior monologue. So since reality is actually inside, and this inside is our consciousness, our mind, not our body, not our five senses. So that inside is not kind of codified, not patterned, not structured. It's all very fluid. When our body sleeps, even our mind does not sleep. It still keeps awake in the form of dreaming or having nightmarish visions and so on and so forth. We stop speaking physically, you all have experienced, we keep speaking within ourselves. We keep speaking to ourselves. Our mind never ceases speaking. Okay? So this is a kind of disjointed stream, disjointed flow of words, ideas, notions, perceptions, indications, hallucinations, hints, glimpses, and all these things. I mean, I move in a kind of jumbled manner, as in a kind of flow. You can never detach a kind of a bucket of water from another bucket when they are within the flow. It is only by kind of taking a bucket of water out of the stream that you can kind of distinguish it. Otherwise, it's one stream. Okay, you cannot say many waters. It's all one water. But at the same point of time, it's not a bucket of water a fistful of water. So that goes on and on 24/7, 365 days in our mind. And the real reality is actually there. Okay, so poets and thinkers, artists, novelists, etc., in modernism and later on, have tried to capture that stream of consciousness, that interior monologue within the human psyche, and wanted to kind of give us a picture of very individual, very subjective reality through those experimentations.
So much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. We have a few more questions, but since we're running a bit out of time, so I guess I'll be sending them over to you via mail. And
yes, we will collect them and send it to you. Yes, if at all you think it is fine with you, sir.
Sure, sure, absolutely, absolutely, absolutely fine by me. No problem.
And participants, don't get disheartened. Your questions will be answered. Just we are just running a bit short of time, so thank you all so much.
Sir, I will not keep you any longer with us. You have been with us for more than 2 hours. Now I've started feeling guilty almost. I would bring the session to a close now. Could not thank you enough, sir. I mean, as I had really said right in the beginning, that you gave us far more than we had actually began with. So I would bring the session to a close. First of all, sir, thank you so much for accepting our proposal in the very first place. And I would like to thank our patron in chief, our principal madam, Dr. Shagota Dash Mohanto, and Orun Kumar Nondi, who's the IQAC coordinator, head of the Department of Economics, so being our constant supports. And for today's technical assessment, I would want to thank Amit Kumar Das. He's from the Department of Geography, and Ohana Bhattacharya, who is from our department, and my students, both semester 3 and semester 5, who have been with us all this while. Thank you so much for being there. Our colleagues of other colleges were there too, but I see that they have left already. So we would actually thank them too. And to you, sir, there could be, you delimited your lecture. So our thank also has to be delimited. We probably cannot thank you enough for this. Thank you, sir. We would now close the session. And there are still comments going on, as you could see, sir. It was a mesmerizing and insightful session that has thrown open for students like us the door to the critical understanding of the entire oeuvre of Eliot. That is one of our students. The rest of the questions, if it would be fine with you, we would mail it to you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. And we would now close the session. Thank you.
Thank you very much for everything, for your participation, for you giving me an opportunity to talk to the students. I only hope very distantly, very remotely, that I was of some help to the students. That's all I can hope for. Thank you very much. My pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir.
Being humble, sir, but we know what we got today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Shorabda. It has been a pleasure to be your student as well. And also, your every lecture has been a treasure. So thank you. Once again.
Students, you please leave the meeting one by one.